Hi, everyone. So I hope you aren't that tired of chickens by now, but I'm afraid I have to continue these types of sort of unsavory, you know, scenarios for a little bit in my talk, in which I will focus a little bit on biases against scientists, and more specifically on moral biases against scientists, in which we look at sort of intuitive morality judgments, really similar to what Will has just been talking about, you know, in relation to atheists, and also more looking more explicitly at moral stereotypes of scientists. So I have been conducting this work together with Steve Heine, who's at the University of British Columbia in Canada, and it's really the studies that I'll present today are really part of a larger sort of ongoing project, which is very much work in progress still. So I really look forward to hearing your thoughts about it. So the question, So the question that we try to answer, or at least sort of provide an initial answer to in this line of work, is do people perceive of scientists as bad people? And we try to get to an initial answer to this question by looking at intuitive morality judgments, as well as more explicit moral stereotypes that people might have about scientists. All right. So if we look at what's already out there in terms of what the general public thinks about us, about scientists, basically, is, you know, it's actually pretty good sort of positive picture. So as you can see up here, I took some screenshots from the from recent surveys, Gallup, for example. What you can see in the UK, US, and Canada is that scientists are actually pretty high up in terms of prestigious occupations. So actually people quite respect scientists in Canada along the lines of nurses, doctors, farmers, veterinarians, and dentists. And people really like their kids to become scientists when they grow up. So it's actually, so this is a good sort of positive picture about scientists. On the other hand, we also know, obviously, that science can garner a certain amount of distrust. If, you know, certain scientific findings, for example, go against people's sort of cherished moral attitudes, you know, think, for example, about topics such as climate change, nanotechnology, or GMOs. Obviously, you can see that there's also sort of a growing distrust against science that has been emerging in the last years in sort of public debates. So, but there hasn't been that much work on perceptions of scientists themselves as the representatives of science, right? So what I did is I took a very scientific approach to this question by using the Google autocomplete function. So what I simply did is type in scientists are. And these are the results. And the results don't look as good as the previous results I show up here. So scientists are not only perceived as stupid, wrong, and idiots, they're also perceived in some extent, you know, in terms of sort of less moral terms. So scientists are perceived as arrogant, and even more shockingly, they're evil, and very likely will go to hell. So that's not really the best picture that is painted about scientists, right? So this is an interesting sort of conflicting observation that you get if you look at, you know, the way the general public sort of perceives scientists. And in the current research, what we try to do is sort of address this ambivalence, this attitudinal ambivalence that people have about scientists, and come up with a few possible reasons for why people would associate scientists with things like arrogance and immorality. So there's a couple of reasons that you can think of for why scientists would be sort of associated with a lack of morality. First of all, science is obviously associated with progress, technological advances. And scientific progress can be scary, right? I mean, if you think about things like atomic energy, the atom bomb, or nanotechnology, again, GMOs, you know, progress can be a little scary and sort of go against what people already, you know, against people's sort of moral attitudes. And there has indeed been some work, we did a little bit of work in that as well, showing that there's actually a negative relation between endorsing technological advance and believing in moral progress. So people, you know, tend to sort of negatively equate the two. So with more technological advance, people become more sort of pessimistic about sort of the future of society and about morality. So that's one reason. Another reason, obviously, is, you know, we're all familiar with sort of archetypes in literature and film. such as Dr. Strangelove or Faust or what have you. So there's this sort of this cultural archetype of the evil and mad scientist, and it might have been further cemented by real life cases of sort of lunatic fringe of the scientist category. Think, for example, about Joseph Mengele or the Unabomber, Ted Kaczynski. And finally, as Will already extensively talked about, and Azim as well, there is this sort of pervasive morality link that exists in people's minds. So many people perceive religion to be some sort of a prerequisite for moral living. And simultaneously, science and religion sometimes come up with sort of competing explanations for the big questions in life. So sometimes science comes up with explanations that are at odds with people's religious faith. So it's not hard to see how science and morality might sometimes not sit too well together. All right. So I'm going to skip this slide. So as Will just now showed you, there is quite a lot of work now on perceptions of atheists. And atheists are not only distrusted and disliked, as Will just showed, but they are also associated with various acts of immorality, ranging from necrobestiality, which is just a fancy term, obviously, for having sex with a dead animal, as well as cannibalism, serial murder, etc., etc. So what we try to do in this project is see to what extent this might also hold for scientists. Okay, let's compare atheists and scientists on the Google test. So as you can see, there's quite a lot of similarities. So they're both wrong, stupid, idiots. But it seems to be the case even that scientists are worse off. They're going to hell, they're evil, you know. And so atheists at least are awesome, but it might also be some sort of a nice alliteration that might cause this. All right. So in the current talk, I'm not actually going to present seven studies, don't worry, that's going to take far too much time. I'm going to just present you with a few examples of the studies that we did where we used the exact same method as Will used, using this conjunction fallacy that has been put forward by Tversky and Kahneman in the 80s. And then if I have some time left, I will also talk about a study looking at more explicit evaluations of the extent to which people think that scientists endorse certain moral foundations. Moral intuitions. Okay, so I can skip this one. Thanks, Will. So this is basically the outline of the studies that we ran, these seven studies. So we had all these different descriptions of quite disturbing immoral behavior: serial murder, incest, necrobestiality, cannibalism, and also cheating and abuse. And then participants were given the option, you know, which were given the question, which option is more probable? The protagonist in the story could be Jack, could be John, is either a sports fan or he's a sports fan, they had to, you know, between subjects, we manipulated the target category that we presented to participants. So it could either be a scientist. We toyed around with different descriptions of scientists as well, but they all sort of garnered this similar results. So I'm just gonna present you with the pooled results for the three categories here. Then we had an atheist target category and a whole bunch of control targets, very much similar to what Will just presented to you. Will had mostly graphic descriptions of the study, so I'll just show the actual scenario. So here above you can see the necrobestiality scenario. This is what participants read, and after this they simply answered the question below. In green you see the serial murder scenario. All right. So this is one example of the results that we got when we presented participants with the serial killer scenario, and we asked participants to indicate, you know, to what do you think that the protagonist is either a sports fan or a sports fan and a scientist. And you can see that the scientists and the atheist categories really provoked the conjunction fallacy in a similar way and more so than one of many control targets. So scientists seem to be right up there with atheists. Another example where we used necrobestiality, and look at that, we, as scientists, outnumber the atheists here. You can see that a little over 60% of people commit the conjunction fallacy here when they read this scenario about a guy having sex with a dead chicken. More so than the atheist category even, but also the difference between atheist and control was significant, which nicely replicates Will's results for necrobestiality. And we also found the same results for the consensual incest scenario as well as a cannibalism scenario. Okay, so what about cheating and abuse? I think especially cheating might be an interesting scenario in terms of, you know, if you think about recent sort of fraud cases in science, but also, you know, general distrust that people might have towards science as an institution based on, you know, if you think about things like climate change, for example. So it would be interesting to see if people also intuitively associate scientists with distrust and cheating. Okay, so we had a scenario like the one Will just told you about this guy who cheats at a poker game. Okay, and we know that atheists provoke the fallacy here to the same extent as for the more disturbing morality violations. So what about scientists? Scientists don't, right? So here we can clearly see how the atheist target provokes the conjunction fallacy to a higher extent than both the scientist targets as well as the control targets. I think that's good news for scientists. Abuse, we had an abuse scenario. It's about this guy getting on a bus, ridiculing this obese woman, and afterwards kicking a puppy. Again, not associated with the scientist target, only with the atheist target. All right. So if you look at these results, what we can see here is if you compare the scientist target with the atheist target, you can see that the results actually quite nicely map onto moral foundations theory. So Azeem already sort of introduced you to moral foundations theory. The most important thing, I guess, to know about the theory for now is that John Haidt, who proposed the theory, basically sort of distinguishes between two types of moral intuitions. One is the what he calls the individualizing moral intuitions related to fairness and care concerns. And then in red, you see the three what he calls binding moral foundations, which are more sort of related to sort of the welfare of the group rather than the welfare of the individual. And what we can see, based on the conjunction fallacy studies at least, is that people seem to associate particularly violations of purity and to a lesser extent, I guess, violations of authority with scientists, but they do not associate violations of fairness and care with scientists. So what about more explicit moral stereotypes? I'll really quickly go through that. So what we expected based on the conjunction fallacy results is that we would find effects on authority and purity mainly, so that people would think that scientists endorse the moral foundations related to authority and purity to a lesser extent than a control target. Okay, so in this study we used the moral stereotypes method, which has been used previously by Jesse Graham. And what we do here is we ask participants to simply fill out the moral foundations questionnaire. I'll give you some examples in a minute, but they have to do this in the third person. So they fill out this questionnaire either as John, who is a scientist, or as John, who is, in this case, a sports fan, which was the control condition. So to give you a few examples, so here are the instructions. So participants read about, you know, the following questions are about John. John is a scientist or a sports fan. What we'd like you to do is to respond to the items below like you believe John would respond. So we had 15 items, three items per moral foundation. Here are a few example items per foundation, which would be quite familiar to you by now. Okay, so and this is what we found. If we look at the care and fairness foundations, we didn't find any differences between the scientist target and the control target. So people think that scientists endorse the moral intuitions related to fairness and care to the same extent as a control target. We did find differences for the three binding moral foundations, though. So participants felt that scientists are less likely to endorse the moral foundations related to loyalty, authority, and purity. Okay. So to briefly sum up the studies that I just presented. So in part one, we found that scientists are associated with disturbing morality violations related to purity and authority, but they are not associated with violations of fairness and care. And the moral stereotype study sort of nicely maps onto this finding by showing that scientists are not perceived as violating the individualizing moral foundations, but they are perceived as, you know, being less endorsing of the binding moral foundations of purity, loyalty, and authority. So if we come back to the question I posed at the beginning of the talk, do people perceive of scientists as bad people? There's obviously not an unequivocal answer to this question, but what we can at least say based on these studies is that it really depends on the moral domain. So what we have is really a mixture of positive and negative associations. So people perceive scientists as playing fair and as, you know, caring about concerns related to care, but they are perceived as being not so, you know, caring about the foundations related to authority, loyalty, and purity. I just would like to thank my co-author on this work, Steve Heine, as well as the AXA Research Fund for funding my research, and thank you very much for your attention.